Hey, everybody, and welcome to Paul Lisnick Behind the Curtain, my opportunity to step away from the world of politics and law that you watch me cover on WGN-TV every day to talk about the world of my true passion, which is theater and the arts. And although as we look at the show we're going to talk about in this episode, arguably in its day, it would have been quite political and perhaps even triggers lots of political discussion today. That's my way of making a tie, you see, to my other world. Because Les Miserables is returning to this area. It's being put on by the Uptown Music Theater of Highland Park. That's a new organization for me in terms of doing this podcast. So I'm so glad we're going to get to meet the players in this show. Let me introduce them to you. I'm going to start with the director of the show, Scott Shallenbarger, I'm going to say that again, Julian, edit that. Scott Shallenbarger, who is the director of this show, but this is your Uptown Music Theater debut, right, Scott?
That is true.
Okay. Yeah. And I think you've been, the Highland Park High School's director of theater arts for, that's where you've been living for over three decades. So I'm sure, and we'll talk about what a challenge Les Miserables is to put up in here, because talk about a big production. And of course, you got to have the stars of the show when you're talking about, I've seen the show, I don't know how many dozens of times I've seen it, so I call myself an expert in this show. And joining us are the true experts, because you're playing the role. Wesly Anthony Clerge is Jean Valjean, prisoner number 24601. Joins us now. Wesly, it's good to see you.
It's a pleasure, Paul. Thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
And David Pfenninger, who plays Javert. Now, a friend of mine I went to high school with at Niles North played Javert on Broadway. Greg Edelman is his name, and he's now for Elephants, and he was Javert. Unfortunately, I mean, the high school days we did West Side Story, it was that kind of stuff, but right. He actually went on to do it for real, as you are doing it for real, up in Highland Park. And if people are familiar with your last name, indeed, we just recently spoke with your wife, Christine, who is starring in The Prom. No competition at home between you two, right? All I know is the two of you have incredible voices.
No, not at all. It's funny because we're supposedly rehearsing in the same space, but we haven't actually driven a rehearsal together yet because our rehearsals haven't lined up. We're both very excited.
So you're yet to save on gas. Okay. Right. Let's talk about Les Miserables. It's a short run. It's only July 26th through August 11th. So you got to get your tickets if you're going to see this soon. Scott, I'm going to start with you because it is a short run, but look, I haven't seen it yet. It hasn't opened, but every production I've seen of Les Miserables, and it's everything from Broadway to touring casts and on, this is one big undertaking.
It is one big undertaking, and I'm so proud of the team that was brought together by the producers and the amazing cast and designers. We're shouldering it. We're moving forward with tons of passion and joy. So real quick, I'd like to acknowledge the short run. We were granted 11 performance license by Cameron McIntosh from London, who owns the piece. And it's a really great backstory that makes my heart very full for theater artists everywhere.
This sounds like a little inside baseball. I'd love to hear it. So you have to call Cameron and say, please, can we do your show?
Well, typically the Les Mis license is not issued to anyone but equity theater companies, let's say Broadway, London, or tours, national or international tours. There is, of course, the high school edition that is allowed on the educational circuit. Our producer courageously wrote Cameron McIntosh a personal letter, and we have a mission with Uptown Theater with this show to support the shooting victims of our July 4th, 2022.
And a portion will go to that, yes.
That is correct. But in addition to the charitable mission, we really wanted a special event for the Highland Park community that could be something we could gather in together, have a ritual together, and perhaps even allow the show to have some healing energy with it. So really the core of it was those goals. And when Cameron McIntosh became aware of them, he kindly granted the license in support of that mission. Which is
a great story. And of course, the Highland Park tragedy of 2 years ago, we covered so extensively on WGN-TV side, of course, and the anniversaries, and we've been there for all of it. It's going to be a long time for that city to heal. But yeah, to give them this gift of one of the great musicals of all time, then yeah, hats off to Cameron McIntosh for allowing this, as you say, special license. That's pretty amazing.
Definitely agree.
No pressure on you, Wesly and David.
No, I think
it's a little intimidating, but also very exciting.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. And I've read your guys' bios and stuff, and you have such, you know, you have to have kind of this operatic sort of bat. You know, one does not say, "I'm a Broadway star. I think I'll go do Les Mis," to do this. So your background has to be deeper than that. And I know both of you have that. By the way, Wesly, the last time Les Mis was here, I interviewed Nick Cartel, who played Jean Valjean. I don't know if you saw that tour. And I tried to get him to do something. Scott may not want you to do this, but he's played it. Nick has played it well over 800 times now, and I tried to get him to change the number from 24601 to just say, make it 02 or something like that. And so he said he would consider that. I don't know if he did, but sort of curious from your perspective, taking on this incredibly classic role, but that too, just like the production's challenging, man. Well, that is bring him home. The numbers you have to do, your voice gets the range.
It's a big thing. It's probably one of the things that I never dreamed that I would have an opportunity to sing, just because of the way that the licensing works. But I'm honored and it's a privilege to be able to sing it and also have the instrument at this point in my career to sing it. Also, in addition, in when you sing Les Mis in other languages, they change the actual number to fit the vowels. So in Spanish, it's like dos, dos, tres, dos, tres, which I always find very interesting. Just in terms of a historical context, I think it's a wonderfully written piece of music and probably, like you said, one of the best scores in music history, in my opinion. And it's an honor and a joy to be able to sing all of these wonderful songs and bring life to them on this stage.
And are we making you like carry Marius as we? I'm not getting into the plot of that yet, but you're gonna have to carry Marius over your shoulder like all the Valjeans do.
Well, I don't want to give too much away, but I think there'll be something along those lines.
Because I actually encourage Nick, the Broadway Valjean, to leave Marius there, and to so you can tell where my podcast interviews go. And I said, change the song from "Bring Him Home" to "Leave Him Here." I have all these ideas, and I think Scott, if you went to Macintosh, I think he'd say, "Do it."
Maybe that'd be the end of Act Two. The narrative couldn't continue. So
That's funny.
it's a much shorter show at that point.
Right, leave him there. Thank you very much. Take a curtain call. All right. So, David, you play the evil. I don't know. Is Javert evil? He's got a job to do.
He lives in a very black and white world, and I don't see him as a bad guy. I see him as just very conflicted, but kind of in a simple way, in the sense that he doesn't see Valjean as anything other than the anti-Javert. Javert brought himself up from, he. I think that's the issue, is that Javert comes from this place of he was from the gutters. He was from the same places that all these crooks and bad guys come from, and he rose up from that. And I think that's kind of his vision of the world, is that he brought himself up, and now he's got to pursue this guy who kind of represents all the things that he struggled to rise above.
Scott, I'm going to come back to you in a minute, but I'm going to come to Wesly for this. Let's learn the plot of this, because, and we're, you know, I never like to give secrets away of a show, but at this point, Les Mis has been playing for so many decades, and the book goes a little bit before that too, that I think people know what this is about. But of course, I want you to tell us what this story is about. It begins with Valjean. All he's done is steal a loaf of bread, right? I mean, imagine today we would just give you the. So, from a plot, I'm going to get a reaction to Scott in a minute about something, but. Give us the plot of Les Miserables. It is about a guy who just wanted to eat.
Yeah, he just wanted to help his family, which, in today's society, that's all we want to do, right? We want to help our family, we want to help ourselves, try and become the best people that we can be. And he was arrested for, as you mentioned, stealing a loaf of bread and put in prison for almost 20 years. And coming out of that, not thinking that he himself was worth anything because he was treated so terribly while he was in prison. And then coming out of that and getting redemption from a bishop who at some point you didn't, he was feeling like he wasn't a person. His humanity was gone. He didn't feel that anyone would help him or take care of him or just even offer him a helping hand. And one man changes his whole trajectory of his whole life, and he dedicates his life to becoming a better man and helping other people as much as he can. And it's really one of the best redemption stories I think I've ever had the pleasure of just being a part of. This it's a man who takes on the challenge of regaining his humanity and with his faith, leading him on the path to righteousness in his view.
And that, you know, and I'm so glad you worded it this way, because I said, what's the plot? And you could have said, well, he steals a loaf of bread. And then this guy, you didn't do that. You basically went right to what this show is really about in terms of its themes and its importance. And I think, Scott, I will come to you now, that's kind of how, when we can sit through Les Mis these days, we don't get trapped by, please, a loaf of bread, get over it. We understand that this musical, this story is about something much deeper than that.
I agree with you. I mean, there's probably a reason its universality has lasted for decades and decades, and people kept coming back for it. I'd like to come back. I don't know if this might tie into your typical political focus on your podcast, but you brought up Javert's moral dilemma. And Javert, as noted, sees the world in very black and white terms. A loaf of bread is stealing, whether it's a loaf of bread to feed your family or not. And we begin to witness Javert going through the uncomfortable understanding that there is indeed a gray area, perhaps, in our world, you know, through a humanistic ethical lens. And I think that's why Les Mis, for me, has such a contemporary feel to it, even though it's been around for so long. We're asked the question, I'll skip to this. My favorite lyric in the show is, to love another person is to see the face of God. And so we're invited to ask ourselves.
I just sang that to myself. Sorry, go ahead.
love it. We're invited to ask ourselves, indeed, in our culture, is empathy and compassion the way that we bring our whole human community into ascension and find the potential of itself versus, right, being so black and white in our thinking, right? And not necessarily seeing the humanity of someone.
You know, you said it. So I sort of like, and I was going to actually ask David this, but I don't script these interviews. I just kind of go where the conversation takes us. And what I was going to ask, and I actually said to myself, don't go there. But I will, because I think you're saying this. And so, David, I'll come to you. I mean, Javert, when you think of all the unrest in these last period of years, George Floyd, those conflicts, you can make a tie to that, right, David?
Yeah, I mean, we've even had conversations on the side during rehearsals with my fellow castmates about that, in the sense that it's hard not to see the current political climate in what we're doing, in the sense that, you know, I as a person see things in various shades of gray, but Javert does not. And so that's been the challenge of the role, is to figure out, how can he not understand redemption when he's such a religious figure? He talks about God and he references higher powers throughout the show, but yet he doesn't understand gray areas. He doesn't understand redemption. He doesn't understand forgiveness. So it's really weird to try to reconcile that. But
you do it through the, you know, I think one of the reasons this story has such lasting impact, it is the music. I mean, you know, I think we've had movies of this without the music, right? But you add the music in and the whole world changed. And Wesly, you commented about that earlier, to sing one of the most beautiful scores ever written. One of the things that strikes me is that when I think of, reach out, touch the face of God, these lines, and you just hear them being sung in your head, the range, the nature of song, master of the house. I mean, the score just gives us so many different emotions and feelings, from humor to depth. And I got to tell you, to this day, no matter how many times I see that show, the song Bring Him Home brings me to tears every single time.
Yeah, it's one of the most heart-wrenching songs I think I've ever had the luxury of singing, because for me, it is a luxury. I never thought I would be able to sing something like that, or even have an opportunity to perform it at this level. And for me, even myself, you know, I get caught up in the moment sometimes when I'm singing it. And in rehearsal, I know there's been plenty of times where I'm like, you know what, I just need a moment to recompose myself, because of the sheer humanity behind it, right? The humanistic nature that is taken during that song. It's a man pleading. He's like, I'm old. I've lived a life. I've done wrong. But this is a young man who who has a whole life ahead of him, who has dreams and aspirations and goals, and you can take me instead, but let the young man live. He has things that he still needs to accomplish.
We really do see that change in Valjean from the beginning till the end. I mean, you know, he might be a thief, he might be whatever, but he's an incredibly lovable person who we which takes us to David in your roles. You know, when I look back at the things you played, Javert, Sweeney, arguably the MC in Cabaret, you like playing these mean people?
It's funny. I had a conversation with my wife about that recently, where I said I'm itching to do some comedy because I feel like in the last several years I've kind of typed into those darker roles, and I feel like I need to get my comedy jam going again, because I did play Nick Bottom a few years back, and I do have some of those comedy chops in me, but I haven't been able to share that on stage recently. But yeah, it's always great to play those darker roles and to get some of that energy out. I can't complain. I've gotten to do some really great things. So
these are meaty roles. Scott, maybe you need to do the producers, and maybe we get David in there.
That's fair. But I have to say, for what it's worth, David is so very effective at going to that dark place. But when you see him in his pivotal ballad in Act Two, you will see a man who knows how to bring vulnerability to the surface, right? And it is a beautiful tenderness that comes through even while playing Javert type.
Yeah. Right? Can I ask you an unfair question, Scott?
Sure.
I think it's unfair, but it's fair. Having seen the show many times on Broadway tours, what I've noticed is that when you go from the Broadway show, which Lord knows how many millions and millions and millions of dollars they spent to do that set, and then they bring it down to the Broadway tours, and it's still fabulous because the sets may be less in terms of the physical structures on them, but these days with video projection and other things, and I'm thinking about Javert's last moments as we've said, not saying what happens to him, but you know, as we see sort of how he departs a particular scene and how that's changed over the years for me. So I'm guessing, maybe I'm wrong, but I'm guessing that the Uptown Music Theater doesn't have billions of dollars for you to put on a production. How did you address that challenge? I mean, when I'm sitting there and I'm watching this show, which I will be, am I going to feel like I am maybe watching a downtown production, or will I sense the fact that this will be presented in a different way?
I think that is a fair question. And I think that you have identified, you know, something we wrestled in the very beginning in pre-production, right? And you will cry when you hear Wesly sing Bring Him Home. I promise you that.
I'll cry because he's not using the lyrics I'm suggesting.
When we first began discussions, knowing that budget-wise, we couldn't do the spectacle in the typical way that you're referring to, the question, my response to that was, the music, as noted, is so profoundly beautiful. My goal was to work with the actors in a way that got them to the most raw core of truth and let the story tell itself through that in the music. We have set pieces, of course. They're beautiful. It's going to accent the world in which the story lives in very meaningful ways. But the heart of this show is the actors and getting down to that very raw sensibility.
You know, I mean, what you just said triggered me. I interviewed the cast of Steppenwolf the other day, Laurie Metcalf and the group.
I saw that show last weekend.
Unbelievable, isn't it?
Agreed.
It's amazing. You'll want to watch my interview with them. It'll go up. I mean, okay. Awkward from when we're doing this now, but Monday you will see that interview. But my point of bringing that up is that the staging in the script basically just tells the director a couch in a void. That's right. What they're told. And I asked Joe Mantello, the director, I said, so did you read that and sort of say, oh, darn, I don't have a lot of direction? His answer was, no, it meant that I can get out of the way of the actors. I'm hearing you say the same thing.
That's right. Get out of the way of the actors and get out of the way of the show. Don't over-conceptualize. Don't gimmick it up. Don't throw stuff at it just to make it something. Get out of its way. Get out of the actor's way and tell a really great story with this music.
Let me also encourage you to go see Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Loved it. And Wesly, let me come back to you. Let's go back to our plot a little bit, because one of the other actors was supposed to join us for this. They were a bit under the weather today, so we let them go. But we have lots of other characters, Cosette and somebody. Tell us about some of the Why am I trying to blank the little boy's name? Gavroche. Talk about some of the other, because it's not only you guys. Like, the whole stage is not filled with you operatic type people. We've got kids. We've got whatever, and it works.
Yeah, no, there's something here for everybody. And one of the best things about this show is that you can find yourself in so many different parts of these characters that who come across the stage, whether it be Cosette, who is Jean Valjean's daughter, right? Gavroche, you know, who's a child, but really a man of the people and tells, you know, the narrative story as well.
And a brave kid.
Yes, absolutely. 1000% brave. And you could find yourself in the students as well, you know, fighting for something that they believe in as well. So there's so many people who come across the stage and different characters that you meet, Fantine and the love of a child and anything to do for their children or for their family or something along those lines. And then you have, you know, the masters of the house as well, right? Madame Thénardier and Monsieur Thénardier, who also are just probably one of the best comedic reliefs I think I've ever had the pleasure of working with. And just
David, are you understudying these roles? I'm just curious.
I'm focused solely on what I've got.
Okay. You wanted comedy. I was trying to get you there. Okay. Yeah, sorry. Go ahead, Wesley. Sure.
No, it's magical. And David and I had the pleasure of working together before. And, you know, one of the best things that we got to do is just, we can really get into the thick of it, right? When acting with David and performing with David, it's like, I know for a fact that there is going to be a lot of aggression and vulnerability and anger. And you're going to see all of those dynamics change throughout every scene that we have together. And it's one of the best, it's a joy for me. Every time we get to share the stage, I'm like, oh yeah, let's do more. Let's have fun. Let's get into the thick of it. So it's really, really, really a joy. And I can't wait for people to see it.
And by the way, Scott, while you talked about the set and all that, I was asking about it. Something Wesley just said triggered this in my head, which is one thing you do, I'm sure, work with a lot so important in this show. And I think about it when I think of Fantine, the lighting. My guess is you do have a lot of freedom to do some amazing things with the lighting.
You're exactly right. You're exactly right. A poetic landscape that is also going to be epic in nature and simple when it needs to be.
Yeah, I love that. So, Scott, close your ears for a minute, because David, I want to ask you about Scott as a director. And what I mean, and I love to ask, I mean, again, with my little Steppenwolf crew, I loved asking everybody this question. My question for you, for there it was about Joe Mantello, here it's about Scott. Is he an actor's director as you work with him? How would you describe the directing style you're experiencing?
100%. He's incredibly collaborative. He gives a lot of freedom to us actors to make our choices without telling us you have to do this and this and this. He kind of just lets us free range and let us kind of explore some things. And if it doesn't work, he lets us know and he gives us some great ideas. It's very collaborative and it's very freeing. And as an actor, that's just something that you can't ask for. You can't ask for more.
Wesley, I maybe you agree with that. Maybe you have a different perspective.
No, I agree. I think we were allowed the opportunity to be an actor's playground, right? Try things that we had maybe thought of and then work with our scene partners and dive deep in and be like, what exactly is, you know, their objective? Are we in conflict? Are we trying to make sure that the point is being come across? And Scott did a really wonderful job during the entire process of sharing exactly like what worked and what didn't work and what was reading well and what wasn't reading well, and allowed just a lot of freedom and that opportunity to play, which as an actor is great because it gives you time to actually figure out what works really well and also what influences and impacts the story and helps it move forward in a positive way.
So Scott, I'll let you defend yourself in this way, and I'll tell you why what the method to that question was, or to my madness. When I asked Mantello that question, the reason was because he actually began his career as an actor, Angels in America and, you know, Normal Heart, and he sort of just, again, he couldn't even explain how he got into the directing thing. It just happened. But he said, I don't know how to describe it. He goes, I just am what I am. I was an actor. I'm a director. I don't know how I got here. I just do what I do. When I looked at your background, Scott, what I saw is a lot of directing. But I also know you've been a director for over 30 years with students. And so I'm sort of curious. I mean, are you an actor's director? Or do you say, actually, I'm just this teacher's director? Because that's the role I've been having. How do you see yourself?
Thank you for the question. You know, that's all of me, what you just said, that must come forward in the rehearsal room, right? I feel there's the teacher in me, and not in a sort of condescending way, right? One thing I think I got from, and I started out as an actor, teach acting. And I think one thing earlier in my career is a quote that I really live by, which is, fear is the enemy of creativity. And when I think about that, it's not just about the creative process, but it's about life itself. When any of us feel locked down and scared of the world or scared of our own impulses, scared of our identities, et cetera, we don't get to blossom, you know? We don't, our authentic voices don't come forward. And so the question becomes, as a teacher, as an actor, as a director, how to eliminate fear, right? And if actors feel that they're being judged or they're being puppeteered, right, that can cause a lot of anxiety and fear because they're something authentic might not be allowed to come forward in that process. So the goal is to say, like, for me, and I think it's happening with both of these actors in the full cast, is how do we remove all the barriers so that their full, beautiful, passionate souls can just resonate on that stage? Because that's what we're going to feel in the audience.
Yeah, that's going to be very powerful. I know that I interviewed the Jersey Boys recently, and they were sort of saying they have no life because of the strain put on their voice. When I say strain, I mean, you know how to sing, but yet, nevertheless, the expectations on your voice night after night, that essentially when the curtain comes down, it's home they go. With the exception of one of them, actually. But it's like, no, I can't be hanging in the bars and having fun. Wesly, how do you take care? I mean, I would argue this role is more demanding even than Jersey Boys. We're not getting the falsetto. Well, no, I guess in Bring Him Home, I don't know if that's a falsetto that you hit. I'm not the music expert. But...
yeah, falsetto, a mix in there. It's a process, I'm not going to lie. But it is incredibly challenging. But one of the things that I just do is I make sure that there are certain events that I can't go to. Like you said, you know, sometimes I'm not going to the bar and hanging out. Sometimes it's like during intermission, it's like, I'm making sure I'm having my tea in the middle of, you know, in the middle of scenes or something along those lines. Make sure I'm just being quiet and being like, you know what, I got to save this for the next day. But a lot of it is just making sure that I remain vocally at the top of my game and having a process that I do every night. Every night after rehearsal or something along those lines, I always have a cup of tea with honey and lemon. That's one of my processes that I use every single day when I come home. It's the first thing I put on the kettle, and then we go right into just the wind down for the evening and make sure that the next day we're able to do it again.
I have this tea, by the way, I'm going to recommend to you. It's I do a lot of speaking and whatever, and so but I find tea acidic. There's a particular tea, the name of which I'm drawing a blank on, boxes upstairs, but I'm going to send it to you because it's not acidic. It is phenomenal for voice. So I'll send you the name of this. Not one you would know. It's not Lipton or something like that. All due respect to Lipton. And David, I'm guessing we don't worry about you going out because Christine says you're staying home. I'm not the one with the voice strain. I'm going out.
I tend to be a homebody anyway. So, generally after rehearsals, I head home. I've tried to be better about not only doing a warm up process, but also kind of a cool down. So like after rehearsal, I'll just kind of do some gentle vocalizations in the car when I get home, just to kind of settle the voice down. I'm a teacher, so normally during the school year, my voice kind of naturally warms up during the day. That's the challenge of doing a summer show, is I'm off, and so I'm not using my voice as much, so I have to be much more diligent about doing the right things so that I'm not doing inappropriate things with my voice.
Yeah. Scott, what did you do to get, because these actors, you know, there's some shows where you have to build a relationship, a camaraderie between them. And it's nice to have that anyway in terms of performance. But here, you know, Javert and Valjean are not exactly going bowling together, you know, in the story. So what did you do, Scott, to get your cast ready to develop the kinds of relationships they needed to have? Because I'm assuming you didn't say, hi, welcome, let's start doing the show.
Yeah, I mean, the guys could probably answer this objectively, you know, from their experience. One of my primary goals was to just kick off by stating my values, which is leading with kindness, collaborating authentically, not just throwing that word around and then not doing it, as I've been some part of some processes with, and building the human relationships. And I think part of that comes in, hopefully, guys, you agree with this, is being in that space together and honoring each other's voices. And when you begin to trust that, right, just like any relationship, you can move forward pretty quickly. And so I think building that trust in that framework of values was really helpful to get the cast on the same page and moving forward.
Scott, I'm going to keep with you in this question. You get all the unfair questions. And
oh, I think you froze up.
Why should I come see it again?
Oh my God. There's so many reasons. We could have a whole nother episode on this one. But if I could get down to the core of it, it's a little philosophical. I mean, you should come see it because it's damn entertaining. And this cast is amazing. We had 650 people audition for this show. And you have a cast of 44 that is singing and acting their guts out. You know,
and by the way, an orchestra of 21. So it's not like you got a guy with a kazoo providing the musical background here.
That's right. So it's incredibly entertaining. But why should you come see it? Because, and I'm going to come back to our 4th of July experience here. But if we scope that out, we're living in some pretty tumultuous times. We all know that. And I believe that it's very easy to become cynical. At the most, devastatingly despairing, right, about everything that's happening. Come see this show because you will be reminded that love and compassion cannot be diminished in that darkness. The darkness has a lot of power, right? But there is light. And if you want to leave feeling inspired to know that, to walk back into life, holding on to some hope, come see this show.
And Wesly, I'm sure you've seen Les Mis over the course of the last 20, almost 30 years, a few times. So how is it that you, so is your preparation, I went and read the Victor Hugo book again, or do you sort of say, well, I love Nick Hartel when he was in town, I'm going to take pieces of that, or is there a way you go, no, this is about Wesly, and I'm putting out of my head everybody I've seen do this?
A combination of all of those things together, right? I did reread the book. I told myself, I was like, I need to do a lot of background research. I need to make sure that I'm honoring everything that was said in the novel, as well as all of the things that are said in the score as well. But I also didn't want to try and mimic or copy anybody else that I had seen do it as well. So I actually made it a point not to listen to other recordings or productions of Les Miserables because
in your daily routine?
No. I wanted to make it as authentic as it possibly could be from my perspective. I am to my knowledge, I'm the second person of color to ever play this role. And so I didn't want there to be a preconceived notion that was going to be coming along with, oh, well, you know, I'm going to do it how Alfred Bell did it or how Nick Hartel did it or something along those lines. I wanted it to be mine and leave my imprint on there as much as I could. And I also didn't want to cheat. I didn't want to cheat myself as an actor. This is one of the biggest challenges as an actor that I can undertake. And I didn't want to cheat the process. I wanted to sit there and do the work and write down all my notes and be like, who says what about Jean Valjean? How do I feel about them? And it was a joy, you know, because I redeveloped an understanding of the character that I didn't have beforehand. So I wanted to make sure that I sat there and did the work. So it's not going to be a production of Les Mis that you've ever seen before. It's going to be something of its own.
And David, for Javert, I guess it's really the same question. I'm assuming Greg Edelman was your model, and I will text Greg as soon as this interview is over, so you watch what you say. Any influences for you in that? I'm kidding, I'm not going to text Greg. Any influences for you?
Obviously I have listened to various recordings. Oddly enough, I wasn't as familiar with the show as a lot of people. I mean, growing up, I knew it was a show that was big when I was in middle school, high school, college. But it wasn't a show that I knew the soundtrack forward and backwards. With that said, I have listened to some recordings. But I think Wes totally hit the correct points that it's really important for us actors to make things our own. Otherwise, they come across artificial. And so I'm trying to find those moments. I'm trying to find the performance in general where it sounds like me doing the role. And I don't want it to be like, oh, he's Philip Quast or he's Norm Lewis. You know, I'm trying to make Javert my own.
Probably, you didn't say Greg, so I'm going to let him know.
And Greg, of course.
Greg, Scott, just the final question as we come to the end of our time here. But when I looked at the shows you've directed, Six Degrees of Separation, Hotel Baltimore, I mean, on and on. This theme, Love, Valor, Compassion, I love that show. This seems like one of the bigger shows of your directing career.
Yeah, I mean, in this space, that's true. And the roots are the same, though, right? Like, I was a kid in the 90s that grew up in the off-loop Chicago theater scene. When Steppenwolf was growing into its big self, I grew up on that raw, primal acting style, both as an actor and as a director. And so when you get down to it, every great story told in the theater, I think, comes down to that. And then you just get to ask the question, how is that magnified for the specific genre that it happens to be a part of? Right.
Well, I can't wait for this. I mean, I was so thrilled when I saw Les Mis was being put on. The dates again for folks watching or listening to us, July 26th to August 11th. It's only 11 performances. Thank you, Cameron Macintosh, as we've learned. It's going to be performed at the Deerfield Performing Arts Center, which is 1959 Waukegan Road in Deerfield. Tickets at uptownhp.org, stands for Highland Park, uptownhp.org. Break legs, everybody. I can't wait to see you all and see you in the run. This is going to be an exciting show, probably one of the best Uptowns ever done. And I congratulate you all. And thanks for spending some time with me.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Paul. Appreciate it.
Be well. Break legs. I will see you on stage.